Hello. Thank you very much for coming. It's nice to have Here, better. Okay. Okay. Thank you for joining. It's nice to have this packed room. This is me. And before I start, well, this is me. I am no more young. Before start, a quick question to everyone. Who knows what is blockchain? Okay, and who knows the economic concept behind blockchain? And what about smart contract? Okay, nice. Just to understand how to go faster with my presentation. Okay, I'm not speaking about market, crypto value markets, and everything related. Don't ask a question about it during the presentation, at least. We can discuss later if you want, but it's not the interest of my presentation. We are talking about blockchain as a general ledger and as a development point of view. So we will start with a brief introduction of the blockchain concept and the cryptocurrency, then we switch to smart contract, and finally I'll show you some code. I'm not going to get live code because I wouldn't need much more time to do live code on smart contract, but I'll show you some code really working in my live code sessions. What is basically blockchain? Blockchain is a distributed ledger, and what is a ledger is something to write data and collect data and keep data forever, more or less. The most used data is money transaction at the moment, but it's not the only data you can record. You can see blockchain as something transparent that you can always read. Could be a book, if you consider the ledger to store generic data, or it can be just for coin. But the main concept is that it's transparent, so everyone could look inside and see the history of the blockchain. A few definitions about blockchain from The Guardian and Wikipedia, and some very important word: a digital ledger recording transaction is a secure recording transaction, but also agreement and contract. Secure the used cryptography with hash pointer, inherently resistant to modification of data, and can record in a verifiable and permanent way. You can read all the definition, but this is key concept of blockchain. Let's see what they are. It's a ledger of transaction and data. It's persistent, secure, and unmodifiable, based on computational trust. We will see what I mean with computational trust. It's distributed and unstoppable. That is the most important characteristic for a developer point of view, I think. Transaction parties are anonymous, but transactions are public and verifiable. You know, it's transparent, as I was saying just before. And its transaction could be about values, cryptocurrency, but not only, but could be about values, and it's something totally new. And it's trustless about nodes and the users. So it's based on computational trust, but it's trustless about users. That's the two key concepts, and we will see why and how. Let's start with some basic concept in blockchain, explained with a few, I hope, clear images. This is a series of tweets I did last year called Blockchain by Images. And let's start with the first concept, that is the hash. When you compute an hash, you have a set of data, and the result is a number. And it's quite easy to compute this number, but it's NPR'd, so quite impossible to guess the data from the number. The easiest explanation is that if you take blue, yellow, and red colors and put together in a certain amount for each color, you get only one brown. But I think no one of you could guess how many blue, how many yellow, and how many red you put to get this brown. So it's easy if you know the quantity of colors to get always the same brown, but it's quite impossible just looking at the brown, guessing the colors. Cryptography used to lock data, the private key and the public key. The public key is used to lock the data, and while the private key is the only key you can use to unlock the data. Otherwise, if you use it to sign, you use private key to sign a mail, and you get this unique stamp that is the public key. So depends on which way you are using public and private key. And finally, why blockchain is immutable? We say that a blockchain is immutable. The concept is the same of a tower of cards. If you want to change this card with, I don't know, a 4, for example, you have to remove this card and put the other one. But removing this card, all the tower will be broken. And just looking at the top of the tower, you can guess that someone is doing something wrong in the base. So in the old history. Imagine it as the history built on top, on top, on top, on top, on top. And just looking at the end of the history, you can guess that someone is trying to change without permission the history. Okay, we just had a nice presentation about consensus. In general, in blockchain, we are trying to solve the general Byzantine problem. The general Byzantine problem is saying that a lot of parties, we have N generals, and some of them are traitors. They need to communicate and agree on just one strategy to attack Byzantio, and only find an agreement and attacking with the same strategy for more than an half of all troops, they could get Byzantio, and they could communicate only through the messaging and passing. And so we need to find an algorithm to achieve this. So find an agreement, a consensus, between at least an half of those troops, considering that some of them are traitors and no one is trusting other parties. Could be solved in various ways, from an easy voting system, but in a permissionless system, so where no one is trusting other nodes, system can trust a node and generals. It could be attacked by an attack called a Sybil attack, so if more than half of these general are traitors, you can't guess they are traitors, and the attack to Byzantio will fail. So need a proof of ownership to defend against a Sybil attack. Proof of ownership is a general consensus terms to say that I need that each party prove to other they are honest and that they are not traitors. How to do that? Well, the most used algorithm is proof of work. Basically, in proof of work, I'm proofing that I'm not a traitor because I'm doing a lot of computation. A lot of computation that means money on the end because you spend a lot of energy to do a lot of computation. And so is this proof of ownership is based on computing this puzzle. Only solving the puzzle, a miner could mine a block, and we will see in a demo. But we have a mining farming like this. This is not one of the biggest one. Bitcoin last year, there is estimation that Bitcoin last year used the same electric power of Switzerland to mine Bitcoin during the year. So there is other possible algorithm. In my presentation is not about those algorithms, but the most used one in a public blockchain. We had a presentation before that, considering not only public blockchain, but also distributed ledger and so on, using different algorithms. But in a public blockchain, the other one very used is proof of stake. Is a proof of ownership using a digital asset instead of computational power. More or less is that I own my cryptocurrency and I bet with my cryptocurrency on the block that is right. If I bet my cryptocurrency, I don't want to risk this block is discarded because I'm a traitor, because I'm losing my money. Otherwise, I'm getting a little price if I'm not a traitor and I'm betting on the right block. Even if it seems that is not democratic, because if you own a lot of money, you can vote more, it's in fact more democratic because there is no scaling on your cryptocurrency. My Ethereum, that is, or my Bitcoin, to mention the most famous one, is like yours and yours and yours. While my power is different from the one of a big mining farm because there is a scale economy on that. Having a very big mine farm is less expensive in terms of how many power I can have than having a lot of laptop. And so, in fact, it became more democratic. I have to speed up a bit. Let's see those concepts in a nice demo. So, we start with hash. What is an hash? I compute data, and this number, is changing. Two things interesting, because it's sufficient to change just one word, just one bit, in fact, and the hash change, but the same word generates the same hash, always. Look, if I reuse AA, I get the same hash that I had before. Okay, how do you use it in a block? What is a block? A block is nothing else than data, a block number, and another number called nonce, that means nonsense. And what is that? Is the number, this is for Bitcoin, it's not always true for every cryptocurrency, but for Bitcoin, the rules for a valid block, a signed block, is that is hash start with 40. If I change data, as expected, the hash change, and is not starting from zero. So what are doing miners? They are finding the nonsense number to have an hash, because the hash is computed on block number, nonsense, and data, that start with 4-0. And the algorithm is written in a way that is, as I said, is extremely hard to start from an hash and guess data, and is quite easy start from the data and get the hash. So what are doing miners? They are trying with nonsense 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, until they reach an hash starting with 4-0. And how is used in a blockchain? Blockchain is nothing else than a chain of those blocks. So whatever, a block number, a nonsense, a data, the hash computed, but also another data that is a pointer to previous block. So what's happening? If I want to change a data in block 2, that is an older block, let's do that. I'm invalidating not only block 2, but all block pointing to that, because I'm changing this hash, and so the pointer is no more valid. It's changing the pointer, and so it's changing the hash of the other, and so on. And so, like Tower of Cards, just looking at the last block that is not valid, I could guess that something has been invalidated in the past. So it's very hard to change an older block. Why? Because if I want to, if I'm a miner and I'm a traitor and I want to change what is already written in an old block and I want to change it, for example, in this block 2, there was a transaction that gave one Bitcoin by me to him. But as traitor, I wanted to write that is the opposite side, is giving one Bitcoin to me. I have to change data of block 2. And then, to have a valid blockchain, I have to mine this block, and then this block. And sometimes require a bit of time, as you can see. And this block. And it's very, very expensive. Very, very expensive. And that said, since blockchain is distributed, so all blocks are copied on every node of blockchain, before I could finish to mine all block, someone else can guess that I'm doing that and mark my node as invalid. This is the reason, because it's becoming very, very, very hard to change blockchain. Okay. Any question on this? Okay, let's go on. But I told you that it is also distributed and unstoppable. Yes, because every node connects to each other and verify the chain on other nodes. But this is a very old image from 72, I think, about what is a centralized, decentralized and distributed system. But the interesting part is what happens if a centralized system is under attack. The same for decentralized and distributed. For centralized one, this happens. All the system go down. For decentralized one, like cloud, a part of the network go down. for distributed system, just that. Just the node under attack. And so, let's switch to economic concept about blockchain. The question I get most when I talk about blockchain is, okay, but why these cryptocurrencies has a value? Because they are nothing, they are not euros, they are not dollars. There isn't any bank. But in economy, in general, intrinsic value doesn't exist as concept. Things has value because of convention mainly, for main four reasons. I wrote three, but it's four. sorry. Because it's rare, it's harder to reproduce, it could be exchanged, and someone wants to buy it. So, some example. Euro, it's rare, quiet. It's harder to reproduce. It could be exchanged. Yes, it's easy to exchange an euro. And someone wants to buy it because, yes, we are using as money. But also this, this is a paint from Fontana. I don't know how many of you knows contemporary arts that hasn't value. If you look at this, it's just a slicing the paint. But last bet was 8 million euros for this paint. Because it's rare, it's hard to reproduce, more or less. It could be exchanged, and someone wants to buy it. And what about Bitcoin? Well, 7K euro last year, not today. Bitcoin is the same. It's rare because there is a limited number of Bitcoin produced in the network. It's hard to reproduce because of cryptocurrency, cryptography algorithms that I've tried to explain. It could be exchanged for sure, and a lot of people want to buy it right now. But another artist. Artist thing that is a sheet of artist, 275,000 euros. So it's hard to reproduce, it's rare, it's hard to reproduce, it could be exchanged, and someone wants to buy it. It's strange, but it is. So traditional payment need a central authority, a bank. And could be done with cash or credit card or whatever, but always need a central authority emitting something. But the question is, isn't okay to simply trust a bank? What could happen? Well, could happen what happened at Lehman Brothers. Like this. So, what is the solution? Grandmama solution? Well, could become a bit unpractical if you are lucky to have a lot of money. So the solution could be, or is, the blockchain. Because its transaction could be values, and it's trustless about node and the user. So, I'm putting my money in a trustless system? Well, depending on what does it mean, a trustless system. You are not trusting in peers of transaction or even in nodes of the network. You are trusting the protocol itself. something that you are doing every day. Every day already, really. When you use cash. Because you don't trust people giving you cash, but you trust cash itself, the protocol. And in fact, maybe today you have been in a cafe to get a cafe, and you have a big banknote, and the bartender doesn't verify your identity. It just verify your money, because it trusts the money, it don't trust you. Okay, that's almost all introducing blockchain in general and the economic concept behind the blockchain. I'm going to switch to smart contract. Normally, when I do this presentation here, I stop for a moment and ask if anyone has any question about what I just presented before switching to smart contract. Do you have any question? Okay, cool. Let's switch to smart contract. What is a smart contract? Well, start from the contract itself. By definition, again from Wikipedia, a contract is a voluntary arrangement between two or more parties that is enforceable by law as a binding legal agreement. And Wikipedia defines a smart contract as a computer protocol intended to facilitate, verify, or enforce the negotiation or performance of a contract. In other words, smart contract is general purpose computation that takes place on a blockchain, a computer program, nothing else. How can we use smart contract to make what is called in blockchain world unstoppable distributed application? That is distributed because it runs on the blockchain, and blockchain is distributed, as I just presented. Can transfer money and asset, can, not necessarily does, but can. And is state history, because what is a computer program? A sequence of instruction with a state. This state is written on the blockchain, so the state itself is unchangeable, unmodifiable. We will talk about Ethereum. It is not the only solution nowadays to write a smart contract in a blockchain. There is a lot of other blockchain implementing a smart contract concept. Just a few like Tron, EOS, NEO are very, very promising. Ethereum has been and is the first blockchain implemented smart contract concept, and so it is nice to look at this because everyone is taking ideas from Ethereum and implementing in a different way. Moreover, is the most active blockchain in terms of research and development, and in particular on smart contracts, and with a lot of smart guys working on this. Let's try to go quick. Every node runs a built-in virtual machine called Ethereum Virtual Machine. It provides a compiler from high-level language to AVM, like JVM for all languages. And in Ethereum, we have two different kind of account, externally owned account, that is user account, nothing else. Is a private key that you can use to transfer Ethereum, like the private key you use to transfer Bitcoin, and is the same private key that you use to execute smart contract, and the contract account, they are controlled by code. Nothing else than a smart contract in a node that could receive Ethereum money and could receive a call to its code. Ethereum virtual machine is interesting for a lot of reasons. The two main reasons is because it is a Turing complete virtual machine, so you can do everything with a Turing complete virtual machine. And has a lot of high-level language compiling for AVM already. The most used is Solidity, that is C Java-like syntax, written with smart contract and blockchain in mind. But also Viper, that is a Python-like, is quite used. The other one is more for research and development. EVM code execution, transaction sent to a contract address, is nothing else than a call for code, like a REST call. The important concept is that every full node of Ethereum run the code at this address and store the state. So every node in the network connected peer-to-peer with other nodes execute what is called. So not only the node you are connecting, but all the nodes on the network will execute your code. Why? Because every node calculates the state to write on the blockchain and calculate the hash, and then everything will be unchangeable, as I said before. Smart contract code can run any program because it's a Turing complete machine, read, write a state, call another contract, so you can make a distributed system with a multiple contract communicate, and could send Ethereum to other address, both other contract or also to users. So you can write, for example, a contract that receive an instruction, verify some condition, and only if those condition has been verified, transfer money to the other party. So for example, again, me and him need to transfer some money, but this money will be transferred only when my package will be delivered at his home. So I send some money to the contract saying that I'm sending the package, and when he will receive it, instead when he sign DHL receipt, it call again the smart contract, and at that point his money come back to me. There is a problem to solve, of course, in every distributed system that is called the halting problem. It's an NPR problem, and it's defined by Turing itself, and it's impossible to determine if a program will finish running or continue to run forever using the same machine. So you can't know when you start a program if it will finish or not. The most easy example is a cycle with a condition that never verify. And okay, on your laptop, what happens? CPU go to 100%, and at some point you decide that it's time for kill the process. But in a distributed system, it's not possible to do like this, because again, the code is running on every single node, and you don't control any node apart from yours. So the solution is to put a fee on every computational step, called gas. Gas is not exactly a currency. It's just a unit of a measurement for computational step. And then using a gas cost, this is translated in a cost. So everything you run in Ethereum has a cost for you, because you are paying computational power of others, more or less, and you solve the halting problem. Again, with a few images could be clearer. When you start a transaction, you have some gas cost. How many gas you need to do 100 kilometer, and you put in each transaction a gas limit, so how much you want to spend, how many fuel you are putting in your car, and there is some gas price. So combining how many gas you need and how much gas you are going to spend and the gas price, you determine the cost of the transaction. And of course, if you put a gas limit for your transaction too low to solve the problem, you run out of gas. And it means that you are losing what you invested as gas, but you don't get the end of the transaction. To get the unstoppable world computer, the most important point is every full node of Ethereum run the code at this address and store the state. But what is the problem with that? The world computer at the moment performing like this. When you run a smart contract, you have to expect a computational power like a Raspberry, no more than that. And it's busy. This is the number of transactions in Ethereum over the years. And this is, in fact, percentage of utilization. So we are reaching the full the maximum power already, because in any blockchain there is a problem of scalability, of course, but scalability is a trilemma in blockchain world, because if you put more power on scalability, you lose on security and decentralization. They are important concepts too, and so you have to find a solution not losing any of these the three important concepts. There is different scalability solution based off-chain or on-chain. Off-chain solution is moving out from blockchain some of the computation. On-chain solution is to split, more or less, to split blockchain in sub-chains and work with more efficient algorithm of consensus like proof of stake. Let's come to how to write smart contract. Solidity is the most used language at the moment, not only by Ethereum, but for example also Tron and Neo are using Solidity. EOS write in C++ like language. Anyway, Solidity is a C Java like syntax, is statically typed, support inheritance, even multiple. Complex user-defined types called struct, polymorphism, and overriding. So it's a complete language, a complete modern language. Let's see some code. Well, this is an easy code to explain written in Solidity. What is doing that is a smart notary. So we are notarizing some document. The idea is to get a document written in PDF, Word, whatever you want. Compute an hash of this document and write this hash with my account on Ethereum and a date. That is the date when I computed the hash. Why is very important? Because with this, you can prove that that document with that specific hash is written by you in a certain date and is written in blockchain, and so no one can trick others saying that that document is yours. It's exactly what a lawyer is doing, at least in Italy, signing a document for example when you buy an house or a car or everything else. So with this solution in the future, maybe when well, it's already possible in some state like Ukraine and another one, I don't remember, maybe Hong Kong, using a smart contract and blockchain to prove that a specific document is signed and unchangeable. What we are doing, basically, we write this smart contract that we will deploy on the blockchain, and it's very, very easy because you set the file hash. This file hash is written in this struct, that is file details, and this is the state of the program because they are what we would call instance variable in Java, but those instance variable is written in the state of the smart contract, and the state of smart contract is written on blockchain. So we are memorizing on blockchain this struct. And this struct is a file details having a timestamp, a message sender. So the message sender is a special variable containing the address and private, public key of who is calling the contract. And then everyone, well, we are paying for that with a message value. So when I call this, I have to pay, so put also some Ethereum in my transaction, and this payment will be registered to the contract, and only the owner, so who created the contract, could transfer this balance that is owned by the contract itself to his own address. And so, getting the money from the contract to me. Then anyone with a public view, so not paying, could ask the blockchain, given a file hash, when it has written and from who. This is a very, very simple example, but giving idea of the power of that. And then you can interact with it with just simple JavaScript. Set function is calling the smart notary deployed on my blockchain, calling with a file hash and a certain amount of Ether, and updating the status. This is very, very simple code, but doing already something very powerful and very different from anything else you can do with a standard with standard code. But of course, every smart contract could, and almost of them, transfer money. And so there is a lot of security. You probably read that blockchain has been attacked a few times now, and 10 million euros has been transferred from a contract to another, and so on. Almost attack is not to the blockchain itself. No one, as far as I know, because consensus algorithms are very robust, and the blockchain is really unchangeable. But the problem is with smart contract, because we are writing a lot of smart contract. I read just yesterday that Ethereum, Tron, and NEO together has now more than 10,000 smart contract deployed, and everyone is doing a smart contract. And while developer of Ethereum or Bitcoin or NEO and so on are incredible smart people, not everyone writing a smart contract is the same. And so there is a lot of wrong code that you can write in a smart contract and have losing money. This is one of the most famous attack, called the Rentrancy attack. It costed about 20 million euros in Ethereum. What is the point here? The point is that they have a smart contract having a user balance, and the opportunity for each user to withdraw their balance. The problem is that the user balance is updated after the value has been transferred. So what the attack did? The attack wrote another smart contract that is with a reentrancy code, calling again withdraw as on the event of receiving amount. So in fact, you have a reentrancy before the balance has been set. So writing a good smart contract, those smart contract is withdrawing everything multiple times until the gas for transaction doesn't end. But the user balance is not updated, and so it can go on and on and on and on. This is the attack of a smart contract. Very, very simple. Function empty, payable, redo, withdraw. Function empty, payable is called every time someone try to pay you, even with an error. And so doing that is they wrote a reentrancy code. There is a solution, of course. Easy solution is to move the change of balance just before the withdraw. Okay, I'm in the end of my presentation. I'm out of time. Really? 50 minutes. It's the last minute, and I'm ending. It's strange, because normally I'm going out of time. The end of my presentation is who is behind Ethereum? A very young, extremely focused guy, and someone looking at this picture or meeting him in person, I met him in person last year, say, well, also a bit strange guy. Well, don't you recall another very young, extremely focused guy 20 years ago. I recall him. He is a Linus Torvald, of course, drinking a beer after release of Linux 0.1. Thank you.